Welcome back to Represent NYC on the Manhattan Neighborhood Network. Again, I'm Victoria Burt. I'm the producer of this show. And joining me now is Assemblymember Jan Kort, who represents the 73rd District in New York, which represents, encompasses the Upper East Side, Manhattan, Midtown East, Turtle Bay, and Sutton Place. Did I get it all right? I can't
remember. You got it. You're doing great. Yes.
Okay. So talk to me a little bit about how your constituents have been affected.
Well, it's an incredibly difficult time for all New Yorkers, especially New York City residents, and my constituents are no different. They're undergoing major changes in life that affect them. Two most significant ways are those who are unable to work or may not have their jobs anymore because of the virus, and they work at a place that is closed down or temporarily furloughed. But for most or many, it's a different way of working. It's working remotely, which has its challenges in and of itself. But then you add on the challenges for many of my constituents who have families and have children or have parents to take care of and look in after. It adds another degree of responsibility and stress to their existing life, both working remotely and taking care of their families, additional responsibilities than we all had about 6 weeks ago.
Now, you're obviously not working out of your office. How are your people reaching you? How are your constituents reaching you?
Well, what we did is we created a virtual district office in that people can contact us by phone, by email, by Twitter. By a whole host of means, we've remained accessible to the 130,000 people that I represent. And we affirmatively have been active on specific areas which I think are very directly impact the quality of life of my constituents and their day-to-day subsistence, really. And that includes really pushing the state's Department of Labor to work expeditiously to process people through for their unemployment, because that is one of the most significant problems we all face, is that so many people, through no fault of their own, are not able to work or their companies have closed down. What we have to do, separate and distinct from money coming in from the federal stimulus program, is make sure that their checks are being processed through the state and state government. And that's been a primary function that my office has been intricately involved in over the last 4 or 6 weeks.
I think this week they just updated the process, correct, of filing for unemployment?
For a couple of weeks, people were filing and were not getting confirmation that their applications were processed. They were waiting for phone calls. It was an incomplete, at best, response by a state government. At a minimum, people have to know that their applications have been received and being processed and when they could expect payment. Because after all, this is what people are using to live on, to buy food, to pay for their lives. At least certainty in the aspect that their applications have been processed is what we had been pushing for in what I think the Department of Labor, after some false starts at the beginning, they're doing a better job now.
So you've talked about how many millions of people have lost their jobs. What are some of the ways that you think we can mitigate this economic fallout?
Well, it's going to be very difficult from the state budget perspective. We just passed the state budget on April 2nd or April 3rd. And at the beginning of the year, we were looking at $4 to $6 billion budget deficit. By the time we passed the budget, it was at least a $10 billion budget deficit. And that likely will increase over time because people are still not working at anywhere near the rate they were, so tax receipts are down. In the short term, the only thing that is likely going to be really helpful is money through the federal government through a second and possibly a third or even beyond stimulus package. There's no way at the state level to replicate all that lost income. We will need the help of the federal government. And part of it could be specific to the Medicaid program or education, certainly our hospitals and first responders. But the better approach would be in the scope of block grants from the federal government to the states, similar to what President Obama did when he took office during the recession. And that way gives the states and the cities and the municipalities better options and to tailor how the money can be spent best to help their constituents. Local government and state government knows best how to spend that money in places it will help, but that requires large sums of money in the form of block grants from the federal government.
Are there other ways that the budget has fallen short?
Well, certainly so, at least in my view on the Medicaid redesign. I was not in support of the way in which that was put forth. And secondly, on the rollbacks of portions of the bail reform that we had passed last April and only implemented for about 90 days. We reversed course to some extent, and I disagreed with that, and that is in part or a large part why I voted against that budget bill.
How did it get reversed exactly?
The bill itself had only been, as I said, only been in place 90 some odd days, and there was no statistical analysis or arrest records or bench warrants. There was no data to suggest the bill was not working. What there was a political agenda by coming from certain areas to reverse course on, in my view, have a more carceral approach to pretrial incarceration, essentially locking up more people pretrial based upon presumptions about who they are and what they did, and they being dangerous. Luckily and thankfully, we were able to not accept the concept of dangerousness into our bail laws. But what did come forth was the expansion of categories that are now bail eligible. I think between 12 and 14 new charges that are now bail eligible, and also a new element of probations for those who are on probation. If they engage in conduct that leads to the arrest, even based upon a misdemeanor, they would be eligible to bail. So I thought that was that clearly was a broadening of the scope of those who were going to incarcerate. And I thought it was deeply flawed policy and not supported by any of the data from the last 90-100 days from when the new law was being implemented. And that's why I voted against it.
Are there any positives to what this budget?
Certainly so. Funding essential services. But we face grave difficulties. And we have to be honest about that in terms of the lack of resources. We should have found new revenue options and looked for new revenue options. There were no new revenue enhancements, whether tax increases or one-shot revenue increases. So that was why we ran into problems with Medicaid cuts or flatlining education funding, is because we did nothing creatively, or at least from my view, creatively enough about how to enhance revenue, if not right now, maybe in the fourth quarter or the fourth quarter of this year.
So I want to switch gears a little bit and talk about this primary and the primary election in June. And how do you see the BOE sort of ensuring our safety to get to the polls?
Hopefully we don't have to get to the polls, and that should be the goal. First of all, you look across our country. Historically, other jurisdictions have done mail-in voting as the sole method of voting. I think Portland, Oregon, and some other municipalities out west, and they've had a high level of participation, and there's been no issue with the integrity of the vote. So I think voting by mail is certainly something that we should look at, and we should look at now. The issue is whether the Board of Elections can implement a complete mail-in by vote in such a short period of time. June 23rd is the primary. What they have done under the governor's executive order is, at least a minimum of making it much, much easier to receive absentee ballots and to list essentially physical illness based upon the virus as a cause for all of us to get absentee ballots. And I think that's a good step. And I think the most recent governor's executive order saying that they're going to send out all ballots by mail, but I'll have to check specifically on that executive order. But I think you're seeing a movement towards we want people to vote, to exercise their vote, but we want to do it safely. We don't want what happened in Wisconsin in a presidential primary, that people lining up virtually on top of each other. One, it's not safe, and two, you have extreme low voter turnout. So I think it's incumbent upon all of us in the next several weeks to work with the BOE, with the governor's executive order, to make sure as many people have their ballots as possible within 45 days of the election day so they can vote safely, and that would be at home.
And if the polls are open and if pause has been sort of lifted or is beginning to be lifted, I mean, shouldn't they have the option to go to the polls if they want to?
Then they should, and they will.
With masks, obviously.
With masks and gloves,
right,
and social distancing, and we'll have right, maybe early voting to even spread out those individuals who want to vote in person. But we can dissipate the numbers of those who yeah, vote in line, whether early voting or on the date of the election, by making voting by mail through absentee ballots as easy as possible. And I think a great many of my constituents, I hope they avail themselves of voting by mail, rather than the other option of voting in person.
So it's something interesting. You wrote a letter to the WeWork CEO asking him to close the spaces. Tell me a little bit about what motivated you to do that.
Well, we were getting complaints from constituents who either worked at the WeWork space or brought it to our attention that WeWorks was trying to claim essential status to fit within the governor's executive order so that they continue to operate as they were before the crisis came about. What our view is that WeWorks primarily, the overwhelming majority of tenants within WeWorks space are non-essential, and that on the whole, by allowing to remain open, they were putting everybody in danger. So we wrote the letter to the governor with other elected officials signing on, asking for clarity under the governor's executive order that WeWork should not be able to continue to operate its space as is, because they truly don't fall within the governor's executive order, and they are not providing essential services by and large for the overwhelmingly within their space.
So final question, do you think that the legislative is going to reconvene this year?
I do, and we need to. And we need to remain open virtually with, and we need to continue to do the people's business. And so we should go forth and continue to have a session of some fashion. And also on budgetary matters, we will have to review the budget this year, more so than any other year, as a moving and continuing document. So we'll have to monitor tax receipts and to see what sort of economic stress we're in. And we'll also have to look at how the next round of federal stimulus, when or if it comes, how that affects our budget picture in the state of New York. So for those reasons, both on budget and both we need to continue to do the people's work and being seen doing the people's work in a virtual way through remote voting and otherwise, I strongly support the continuation of the legislative session really throughout this year.
What effect have you seen on the small businesses in your district?
It's been brutal. It's been absolutely brutal for so many small businesses. And you really see the incredible work of so many who run small businesses to keep their employees employed, to try and change the nature of their business on a fly for more takeout. But that's in the food delivery industry. So many of our stores that on the east side that are not delivering food, they've been forced to close. Non-essentials, we're not providing essential services. So the economic impact on those stores is brutal, and we're going to need to help them when we have the resources to. On the other end, for those who are essential and providing food delivery or other perishable items, it's been very difficult to try and change their operations to more of a delivery or a takeout while keeping their employees employed and safe at the same time. So I think they've been doing a remarkable job. We have to help them as elected officials and community people to shop in our districts, to spend our dollars in our districts as best we can to help these stores that remain open get through this very difficult time.
Do you see us opening back up in mid-May?
And that would be guesswork on my part. It's impossible to say. It's on the science and the medicine and whether we're safe to do so. That has to be our guiding principle. So, of course, we'd love to, but we can't before it's safe.
Yeah. Assemblymember Dan Coyd, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Welcome back to Represent NYC on the Manhattan Neighborhood Network. My name is Victoria Bird. I'm the producer of this show. And joining me now is Assemblymember Richard Gottfried. He actually represents my district in Hell's Kitchen, as well as Murray Hill, Midtown, and part of the Lincoln Center area in Manhattan. And Chelsea, okay, you don't forget Chelsea. I'm constantly dropping off neighborhoods. So we talked a little bit before we started to do this interview, and one of the things that we wanted to really talk about is how this pandemic has really highlighted some of the problems that we have in our healthcare system. And can you talk to me a little bit about how what you think those problems are and what some of the solutions could be?
It's pretty clear from the the number of people that have their COVID-19 susceptibility and the severity of their symptoms made worse because of underlying conditions, it's pretty clear that there are a lot of people in our society with a variety of underlying conditions, chronic conditions that that undermine their health, that make them subject to things like COVID-19 or any other infection that can be much worse because of their health condition. This is no surprise to anybody who's paid attention to health and health policy, but I think it's made it a lot more glaring. And also more glaring is the economic and demographic disparities in these conditions, being much more common among low-income New Yorkers and as a result among people of color in New York. I mean, it's not that being Black or Hispanic makes you more susceptible to heart disease. It's that being a low-income person makes you often more susceptible to these various conditions. And we're seeing it also in the work that people do, which can impair their health, can make them subject to whatever ailment is going around, and in this case, it's particularly severe. The other aspect of this is that an awful lot of New Yorkers, when they ought to go to the doctor, don't go because they're concerned about what it will cost them. And these, I'm talking about people who have health coverage, but have coverage with deductibles and copays and the like. And when it costs you money out of pocket to go to the doctor, it's very easy to convince yourself that, I can just, ignore this. It'll probably go away. And with something like COVID-19, people who do that, unfortunately, are more likely to end up dead. The problems in our healthcare system and in our economy and social structure are showing up much more starkly and with much more evident damage to people as a result of the epidemic.
Why do you think, or how do you think, single payer healthcare could have helped?
In several ways. I've always said that every problem we have in health and healthcare is made worse and harder to solve because of the way we pay for healthcare. And that is certainly true with COVID-19. The many New Yorkers who come into this epidemic with serious underlying conditions would be much better off under New York Health because they would all have health coverage. They would have health coverage without deductibles and copays. They would not have restricted provider networks. All of those things make for a healthier population. And the care that people get if they do become infected with COVID-19 would be much more accessible to them with the New York Health Act. And their providers, whether it's a doctor or a hospital, You know, people who go to the doctor or hospital covered by Medicaid or Medicare do not bring adequate funding with them. It's pretty widely understood that Medicaid and Medicare do not really cover the cost of care. Doctors and hospitals accept those plans, particularly Medicare, because they would lose an enormous number of patients if they didn't. But as a result, a lot of our hospitals and other healthcare providers are not as well funded, particularly when they're taking care of a lot of Medicare or Medicaid patients, as they ought to be. That then shows up in staffing shortages and conditions in hospitals and nursing homes that are less than adequate. A lot of the problems we've seen with patients in nursing homes are made worse by the inadequate staffing in those facilities. And that's partly a problem of the fact that we really don't require them to have adequate staffing, although I've sponsored a bill to say that for many, many years, because inadequate funding produces inadequate staffing.
So explain, if you can, it's sort of backing up a little bit, explain what it would mean to have a single-payer healthcare system.
It would mean that every New Yorker would have full comprehensive health coverage with a scope of benefits broader than anything that I know of in the market, including covering long-term care, meaning home health care, nursing home care, and the like.
And this would not be attached to a job.
Right. Everybody would be entitled, whether you work or where you work or how much you earn, et cetera. Just like your kids get to go to public school, whether you pay taxes or not. You know, if your house is on fire, the fire department will come. Whether you are low income and or don't have a job or you're a multimillionaire, it would be a basic public service that we're all entitled to. And in addition to the scope of the benefits, there would be no deductibles, no copays. There would be no restricted provider network, and so no such thing as out-of-network charges. And the bill has language that guarantees that the funding levels paid for these services would be above what we now spend for Medicare and Medicaid, because it requires that those funding levels be related to the cost of providing care and adequate to and sufficient to assure an adequate supply of the care. The other thing that would help to make sure that payment levels for doctors and hospitals and physical therapists and the like would be adequate is that New Yorkers with wealth and power, every member of the legislature, the governor, our families, Mike Bloomberg, George Soros, would all be covered by the same plan as the rest of us. And you can bet that me and my colleagues and the governor and wealthy New Yorkers will make sure that the plan that we are in is as good as can be. And 20 million other New Yorkers will benefit by being in our health plan.
And where does this bill stand now?
It's in the Assembly and Senate. In the Assembly, it's carried by me, as you know, and I chair the Health Committee. In the state Senate, it is carried by Senator Gustavo Rivera from the Bronx, who is chair of the Senate Health Committee. It has passed the Assembly four times in recent years by about 2-1 margins. It's co-sponsored in the Assembly by a very hefty majority of the Assembly members. In the state Senate, we are one vote shy of having a majority of senators as co-sponsors on the bill. It's been at that stage for a while now. It continues to be an uphill fight. You know, the insurance industry is adamantly against it. A lot of our largest hospitals oppose it because, first of all, our biggest hospitals tend to be taken care of reasonably well by insurance companies because everybody wants, you know, Mount Sinai, New York Hospital, what have you, in their network. Smaller community hospitals and the city public hospitals aren't treated anywhere near as well by the insurance industry. And hospitals and physicians are wary of it being one big what they perceive as one big government plan. You know, there are a lot of people in our society who assume if the government is doing it, it must not be any good.
I mean, is this a problem of treating a person's health like a commodity?
You mean our current system?
Yes.
Yeah, our current system basically is on the proposition that if you can pay for it, you get it. And if you can't, you don't. Or if you do get care that you and you can't pay for it, your access to it is much more limited. And you may not be getting the same quality of care. And in the case of home care, there's almost nobody in our society who has insurance coverage for home care. And as a result, you find when a member of the family needs home care on a long-term basis or nursing home care, what generally happens is a lifetime of savings can be wiped out, paying for it. A family member, and in our culture, it's usually a female family member, may give up her career or a large part of her daily life to take care of the loved one who needs constant care. And it can be a much greater financial and personal burden than it ought to be. We should talk a little about how it's paid for. Certainly what a lot of people want to know is, you know, if we're not going to have deductibles and copays, and if all these things are going to be covered, including long-term care, oh my goodness, how can we possibly pay for it? And the answer is that, and this has been studied by a lot of very expert people, the answer is that the total cost of the program will be less than what we now spend for all of these services. And that's because our healthcare system spends an enormous amount of money on the administrative and marketing and profit of insurance companies. I mean, that's tens of billions of dollars that we spend every year on insurance company, unnecessary administrative costs and the like. Our doctors and hospitals and other providers spend enormously more than their counterparts, for example, in Canada, which has a single-payer system, because of the burden of fighting with all those insurance company bureaucrats and getting approval for everything in sight and arguing about whether their bill is going to be paid. And when New York is bargaining with drug companies on behalf of 20 million patients, rather than each insurance company bargaining on its own, we will be able to significantly bring down prescription drug prices. Put that all together, we would be saving about $55 billion every year. And those savings are what enable us to cover everyone, eliminate deductibles and copays and the like, and cover the home healthcare that society is not already paying for.
That's kind of amazing. So basically the cost is covered by the savings.
Exactly. It would be paid for by a progressively graduated tax on both payroll income and non-payroll income like dividends and capital gains and the like. And because the total cost is lower and because the tax would be progressively graduated based on ability to pay. So ultra-wealthy New Yorkers would be paying more than they do today, but I think that's fair, and it would lower the costs for the rest of us. It comes down to where like 90-95% of New Yorkers will be spending significantly less than they are today.
I think about all the people that are now out of work because of the pandemic and that therefore their health insurance will start to disappear as, you know, they are no longer covered by their employer.
Yeah, and, you know, that's an important point here because one of the problems with our current system in which a very large part of the population is dependent on their job providing their health coverage. My health coverage comes through my job. Millions and millions of New Yorkers are in the same position. And so when a lot of people lose their work, lose their job, they lose their health coverage. Under a single payer system, that would be a bad memory of days gone by.
Assemblymember Godfrey, thank you so much for joining us today.
It's been my pleasure.
Welcome back to Represent NYC on the Manhattan Neighborhood Network. I'm Victoria Burt. Right now we're going to talk about something that is something we're pretty much maybe all experiencing, anxiety, stress, and maybe issues with mental health just because of this global pandemic and social distancing and being sort of housebound. And right now I have with me Ashley Womble with Crisis Text Line, which is a really new and interesting way of reaching out for help. Hi, Ashley. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. Thanks so much for having me.
So, what I think is so interesting, just explain to people how you work with people.
Sure. So, when someone feels that they're in crisis, and if it's a crisis to them, it's a crisis to us. They can take their phone out and text crisis to 741-741, and they will get a response back from a crisis counselor. Texting crisis text line is really no different from texting a friend or a family member for help. The difference is that our crisis counselors on the other line are trained at crisis intervention, and you don't know who we are, and you'll probably never talk to that person again. We have been around for almost 7 years. Actually, we're headquartered here in New York, and we have sent and exchanged 150 million messages since we launched. And we have seen a really big surge in texts, especially from New York, since this pandemic.
And is this the only way to reach out to you is through text, right? There's no phone calls or anything like that. So it's just if I'm home and I'm feeling anxiety, feeling stressed, feeling suicidal, any kind of level of intensity, we can reach out.
That's right. That's right. Typically, people text us about depression or school. School's a really big topic for us because 75% of our texters are under the age of 25, so they may be in middle school, high school, or college. Of course, people of all ages can text us. Relationship issues are another big topic that people text us about, including loneliness or abuse. We also are here for people who are suicidal, as you mentioned, and that is suicide and self-harm are common things that people text us about. Right now, in the past 30 days, the vast majority of our conversations have been about anxiety.
And you are a counselor as well, correct?
That's
so
right.
If you can give us, me, anybody who's watching, how do we deal with a couple of things, the isolation?
Sure. So something that we've been finding, there's three things we've been finding that does tend to work. Now, we don't have a magic solution for this. We're all in this together, and we're all struggling to some degree. And but one thing that we have found that does tend to work well as a crisis counselor when you're texting someone who's in crisis, to really talk about this specific moment. Like, what made you reach out for support today? How can we plan the next couple of days for you, right? So really staying kind of in the moment or in the span of time, remembering that this is temporary. It's difficult and temporary for us maybe in New York, it may be another 6 weeks. The mental health effects of this will likely last for years, right? But it's still temporary. And really kind of taking it, it's that old fashioned advice, take it one day at a time, that does tend to work really well. The other thing, the second thing that's really been helping people is identifying other supports in their life. So whenever people text us, we do help them try to identify people that they can talk to in real life, right? Or maybe that's a FaceTime, right? Maybe that is joining an online community, right? But helping them create a community of support that they can be with right now, in addition, of course, to texting with a crisis counselor. And the third thing that's really helping people is knowing that they're not alone. We're really all going through this together. And if you're feeling anxious, if you're feeling isolated, if you're feeling grief, because you've lost someone, or because you're just grieving, the summer plans that you had made, you're not alone. And knowing that you're not alone and having someone to talk to and knowing that this moment is going to pass are all things that tend to really help people.
So your organization can help people who are teenagers, people who are grieving, people with addiction issues, is there anything that you don't sort of cover?
We cover every issue, right? Through our crisis counseling via text. So if people are struggling with addiction, please text us, right? And what we'll do is, we'll talk to you about what made you reach out today. What are some things that we can do to help you get through that hot moment that you're in to a cool calm? And we will give you some referrals. So for example, if you're struggling with addiction, ideally by the end of that conversation, we will have talked about maybe you go to an online AA meeting. Maybe you want to reach out to a therapist, right? Many of our conversations involve therapy. We're not a replacement for therapy, but we are here for you all the time, in your pocket and at your fingertips.
Talk to me about the new For the Frontlines that you just launched.
So one thing that we've noticed through our data, because one of the things that's really interesting about our service is that because a text is a transcript, essentially, we take every message and put it into our data corpus. So we have a layer of machine learning so that we can spot trends, right? We noticed that about 4% of our conversations were people saying just the word essential worker. And remember, that's not a phrase any of us used even back in January, right? So we did a little digging, and we added a question to our survey at the end of a conversation after that person is feeling calm, of course, is when we would ask that sort of information to find out how many of our texters were essential workers or working as a healthcare professional on the front lines. And we found that about 50% of our texters who are texting in because they're in crisis are either an essential worker or have an immediate family member who is. And so we launched a campaign called For the Frontlines, which is really an awareness campaign to let healthcare workers know and frontline workers know that we're here for them. We're providing this service that they can use whenever they're in their break room, right? If they get to go into a break room. That if it's the middle of the night, it's the only time they have a chance to text, we're here for them then. And one of the things that's important about this is that people who are healthcare workers, they tend to be over the age of 25. We typically hear from people who are under the age of 25. So we felt like this was an important opportunity and moment to get our number out to people who really, really need it right now.
And you also have the Mental Health Fund that started with the celebrity Demi Lovato, right?
That's right. So because we have seen an increase in volume, we're about 40% overall, and that's in addition, so that's 40% in an increase to where we typically are. And we've also seen that in the other countries where we operate, which is in Canada, the UK, and Ireland together. And with the support of Demi Lovato, Richard Branson, and a number of corporations, we launched the Mental Health Fund to raise money to help support our efforts, because we have decided that this is a time where we want to make sure that we are reaching people, as many people as we can, as quickly as we can. And so we are staffing up, and this fund helps us do that.
That's good, because you're a nonprofit. So, I mean, you have to be able to run.
That's right. Yeah. So the Mental Health Fund supports our service in all four countries. And then one other thing that we've done to make sure that we get support to as many people as we can, as quickly as we can, is we announced this week, in fact, that instead of launching country by country, as we've been doing, we're going to start launching language by language. And so over the next 2.5 years, we are going to be offering our service everywhere people speak Spanish, English, French, Portuguese, and Arabic.
So currently, right now, you have services available in all those languages, or that's coming?
That's coming. Right now, we're in English only in the U.S., Ireland, and the U.K. We operate in French and English in Canada. By the end of 2022, we expect to be in all five of those languages, anywhere people speak it. We had originally planned to do this in 5 years, but because of COVID and because of this global mental health pandemic, we knew that we needed to do this faster. And so we're working as fast as we can to get the service up in these other languages.
What are some tools that you think that we can share with anybody watching this if they're experiencing anxiety and they just want to hear some things that they might be able to do and not text anybody or call anybody? Is there anything that we can share with them?
Mm-hmm. On our website, we have a special section for people are experiencing anxiety around COVID. And then all of the resources that we share with texters are on our website. So while we would encourage you, if you're in crisis, to text us, if you don't feel comfortable texting, or if you don't feel that you're in crisis and you just want to arm yourself with some resources, you can see those on our website, crisistextline.org.
Okay, so Ashley, tell me if you can, what happens? I text you crisis. How long before I speak to a counselor? What are the steps?
Sure. So you'll text crisis to 741-741. You'll get one automated message. That message will let you know that you've reached crisis text line. There'll be a link to our terms of service, and we'll ask you, what's your crisis? You don't have to tell us your whole life story in that next message. Just say, you know, kind of what you're feeling. We will use that message to triage the conversation, so that if you're in a life-threatening situation, we will make sure that you're connected to a crisis counselor in under 1 minute. All of our conversations, we strive to start within under 5 minutes. Speed is really, really important when you're in crisis. And so we use technology to enable our crisis counselors to get to texters just as quick as possible.
And what are the costs? Does it cost me anything to text you and reach out for help?
It doesn't. And in fact, it won't show up on your phone bill. If the service is free, we're 100% supported through philanthropy and foundations.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk with us, Ashley.
Yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Right now, we're going to talk about what it looks like if you have a case in the court systems in New York. They were marginalized to a really small extent starting in mid-March with when everything went on pause. And right now we're going to find out what is considered an essential matter, what is being seen and heard. And joining us now is Judge Ali, who's also a friend of the show. He's hosted shows. How are you?
Good, Victoria. How are you?
Good, good. So tell me, what is considered an essential matter? What is being heard in front of judges?
Right. First, it is great to be back on Manhattan Neighborhood Network. MNN has a very special place in my heart for the work you do and for the information you disseminate, like the question you're asking me. Our court system is one of our three dynamic branches of government, with the executive and legislative branches that we see are doing very good, hard work every day dealing with this pandemic, but so is our court system. You know, I tell people that there's no playbook for a pandemic. The last time we saw one is at the beginning of the 1900s with the Spanish flu. So it's not like a snowstorm that closes the court system for a day or two. Like, this is a wide sweeping change to our usual business practice. And I believe that our chief judge, Judge DeFiore, Jen DeFiore, chief administrative judge, Larry Marks, George Silver, Edwina Mendelson, they've done a wonderful job. And in New York City, our chief civil court judge, Anthony Canatero, in charge of family court is Jeanette Ruiz, and criminal court, Tomiko Amaker. These judges put their heads together to figure out how to keep the court system running while keeping people safe. And everyone's done their part, court officers, clerks, reporters, interpreters, attorneys. So what's happening now, so my last day in court was March 16th. I was actually on the bench. And on March 17th, we were told courts are closed. But you really can't close the courts completely, right? You might close it to things that do not need to be heard right now, like non-essential filings. You're probably not having jury trials. You're probably not calling in jurors, right? But there are certain things that need to be heard. And those are the, getting to your question, those are the essential matters. So right now, as you know very well, as you were at my induction also, I was elected Manhattan Civil Court, but I'm currently sitting in Bronx Criminal Court. For however long I'm needed in the Bronx. And what we're doing in the Bronx and citywide and statewide are we're hearing arraignments. So arraignments are, for those who are not familiar, it's the first time an individual who's been arrested and has to go through our criminal justice system sees a judge. So those are things you can't really pause, right? If someone's arrested within 24 hours, they should see a judge so that their liberty interests are protected. So that's an essential function. If you're arrested, that should take place. So what's happening now is that it's done remotely. And that was a fantastic job that our court system did. It took a very personal, in-person type of setting where you have an arraignment, you have hundreds of people in the courtroom, you have lots of paper being passed back and forth, and it's a very touchy, you know, touch-based system. Everyone's touching papers, we're seeing each other. You're moving that to a remote setting. So that takes a lot of work. So when I'm judging remotely, it's just like this. I'm on a computer, I'm seeing the parties, I'm seeing the attorneys, I'm seeing the defendants, and that continues to happen. So that's done as an essential matter.
Do you think that will continue after? Do you think that this is going to be, how long do you think this is going to exist like this, once we're sort of off pause?
Right, you know, I have to tell you, I think the virtual arraignments work out fine. You know, they work great. How long would it take? I think it's until we're safe that we know we can go back and be in that close quarters. It's very hard in our court system. I always call the family court and the criminal courts the trial courts. It's the people's courts, right? It's very hard to take a court system like that where it's very busy and congested to turn it into something where we social distance. So the remote part of it could be a while. It could be a while before our court system opens up completely, but that's done to make sure everyone is there safely, but without compromising anyone's liberty interest. So the arraignments might go on for a while like that.
Let me ask you about another area sort of seems to be something that would be pressing and couldn't be put sort of like outside of the box of essentials, is domestic violence.
Yeah.
How is the courts handling that? How are the courts handling that?
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, with what's happening now with the sheltering in place, and you can check whatever stats are available for this, but there's been an uptick in domestic mm-hmm. violence. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you think about it, the abuser in a domestic violence situation, the abuser and the abusee are sheltered together, right? So what we're seeing now, the last arraignment shift I did, if I handled, say, the sum total of cases I handled were 100%, at least 60 to 70% of those cases were domestic violence cases, which is a lot. You know, so if I handled 10 cases, 6 to 7 are domestic violence cases, and they come in because only a court can issue an order of protection. So that's why they come in. In another segment, we could talk about bail reform and what's happening recently with the changes of the law. But with the changes of the law and the bail reform, the police can let someone go right from the precinct. You arrest them, you let them go. They're put through the system if there's a need for certain things, one of them being an order of protection. So we get to see a lot of these cases. What's also important, and then I would like everyone to know who's watching this segment, is that there's still help available for you through our court system. And this is not readily known, but it should be known. And I would like this show to be yet another vehicle for people to know this. One, if you're in a domestic violence situation and the police are called, then cases will come through a judge and the application will be made for an order of protection. Whether or not I grant it, well, that's up to the facts, right? But that's available to you. Another court that's open for essential businesses is our family courts. And that's something that my wife, who's a family court judge, will hear cases and preside. Litigants can still go to our court system and petition for an emergency order protection. So they should not think because we're in a pandemic, the courts are closed and there's no recourse for us, I have to stay in this situation. There's still that vehicle for help. It might not be as familiar, but it's still available. If they go and contact their local courts, a petition can be drawn up and they can see the judge that same day. So with the uptick, there's also help through the court system.
Talk to me about housing court. There's a big, there's a state of evictions right now. What does that mean? And what does that mean when that ends? What does that look like for somebody who's facing eviction?
So when it comes to the essential filings, there's been a sort of pause on non-essential filings. When the governor issued his first executive order, putting a stop, a moratorium, a pause on evictions, that was 90 days, I believe, as of mid-March. So that would put us into mid-July or mid-June. Whether or not there's an extension of that, we have to see what the governor does with his executive order. What it means is that a landlord cannot initiate eviction proceedings in that time. That individual will not be able to file. So a tenant who is, say, falling behind in rent, and there's this whole movement about canceling rent, that's something that that another branch of government is going to have to deal with. It won't make its way to the court system just yet. It might not be forgiven. It might not be totally wiped out. But at least that person who could be facing an eviction won't have to worry about it while the executive order is happening.
So that just means that it literally is on pause.
Yes. Yes, the eviction process. The interesting thing about our legal system is that we can modify it, but unless there's a formal change, the governor can issue these executive orders that puts a halt on things for a certain time period, but it doesn't abate it altogether. So if there's still a grounds for an eviction, that might work its way in back to the courts when we start to accept non-essential filings.
And I looked on the court's website and it said that there's still legal help available by phone and on the web, and there's still a way to get an attorney that's through the website. I mean, there's definitely been a bridge in the gap between being able to go down to the courthouse,
right,
and not being able to, correct?
Right. Well, you know, this is, you know, there's all these silver linings, right, as to what's happening. Our court system, when I started practicing about 20 years ago, we didn't have, obviously, the technology we have today. And we were a very personal-based system where you have to, if you couldn't go down to the court building, you were out of luck, right? You might be able to call somebody. Now, everything is done remotely. And because of the pandemic, we were forced to adjust the way we do business. We being the courts, we being judges. So the help you can get is literally from the comfort of your home and the capacity to have it. A dynamic partnership that was born out of this pandemic was that our Chief Judge DeFiore and Governor Cuomo teamed up to start this initiative to have attorneys volunteer to help individuals, say in eviction proceedings or tenants who could not afford an attorney, to help them handle this. So now this is a partnership between two branches of government to help individuals. So we sort of like shed away our pretension to say, well, that's not my job, when we look at the very human aspect to say we need to help people. So the courts and the executive branch came together and say, there's a real need. Let's help folks. So they started this initiative. It's great. It's a wonderful partnership. Yeah.
Judge Shaw Ali, thank you so much for being with me today.
Thank you, Victoria. Be well.
Be well.